Revered by one sex.
Hess jokingly refers to Viagra as the best legal recreational drug of choice.
Reviled by the other.
Hefner built his empire, selling the idea that women are submissive playthings.
Playboy founder Hugh Hefner is the man who got sex out of the bedroom and onto the coffee table.
Sex is probably the single thing that men are most interested in.
His world, reality laced with fantasy.
Nymphs parking your car. You know, you're greeted by wizards and magicians.
His life mired in controversy.
The real story in that Hefner's plane was being used to transport drugs.
I don't even know what the concept of a bunny is. We weren't sex workers.
His sex empire and the undying spirit of a boy loves to play.
He is Peter Pan. I'll never grow up.
In this hour, Hugh Hefner, the unexpected and surprising desires of the ultimate playboy.
This is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Headliners and Legends. In the early 1950s, Hugh Hefner was a man with a dream, call it a fantasy, about a magazine for men called Playboy. Though it was tamed by today's standards, in 1953, the magazine caused a sensation and helped to usher in the sexual revolution. Playboy was in the right place at the right time, and ever since, its creator, the man known as Hef, has reveled in a life which he once said had no downside.
I know you ain't never met a playboy like me. I know.
The reason he has the playboy image is because he truly is a playboy.
He is extremely romantic. He loves to be touchy-feely. He's a hand-holding kind of guy.
He loves to play, he loves friends, and he loves the gang.
But Hefner's pursuit of pleasure is merely a byproduct of his true passion.
He is the magazine is him. It never would have worked any other way.
He is the quality control officer. He is the first reader.
It's a fantasy for everybody else, but it's not even a fantasy to have. That's it.
Beautiful women, abundant wealth, and worldwide fame. On the surface, it's clear why a man might want to become a playboy. But for Hugh Hefner, the reasons are more complex.
Everything in my life, you can find the clues to from the childhood.
Life begins for Hugh Marston Hefner in Chicago in 1926. Jazz, flappers, and speakeasies are all the rage when Hefner is born on April 9th. He is the first child of Grace and Glenn Hefner, who, due to their strict Puritan convictions, completely shun the party atmosphere of the Roaring Twenties. The couple welcome their second son, Keith, 3 years later.
My parents were robbed of the ability to show emotion of any kind. And that's part of the Puritan heritage, the inability to hug and kiss.
There was a lot of security, but not a lot of demonstrative love.
The family security is threatened during the Depression. Glenn Hefner, an accountant, works day and night to support his wife and sons. He leaves the house before his children wake up and returns after they've gone to bed. The limited contact with his father colors Hefner's personality. He becomes an unusually timid child.
He was so shy when we were very young that he wouldn't answer the phone.
Hefner's parents give him a gift intended to draw him out. Instead, it will affect his life in a far different way.
They gave me my first dog. I named him Browse.
He sadly didn't last very long.
Died after a few days. I had a favorite blanket when I was a kid that had bunny rabbits on it. I called it my bunny blanket. It was my happiness and security blanket. And when I got this dog, I put the blanket in the box with this dog that I loved so much. When the dog died, they had to burn the blanket. So you can get that image of the bunny blanket being burned, and then the boy grows up and turns into the man, creates the bunny empire.
The golden age of Hollywood also inspires young Hefner.
He used to go to the movies a lot, and that was where he had his big escape.
Films about romance fascinate Hefner and expose him to the kind of physical affection that is lacking in his strict puritanical home.
For me, the whole idea of love was defined by and large by the movies, and it came from a notion of romantic love.
The 1934 film, Tarzan and His Mate, introduces 8-year-old Hefner to love as an adventure.
Tarzan, living in harmony with a girl in the jungle with animals, was something that I thought was too delicious, particularly for a kid that was kind of a loner and had problems communicating with his parents. And that Tarzan and His Mate had some nudity in it, had great appeal to a young man.
Hefner is also interested in drawing and exhibits an aptitude that will determine his career path.
I wasn't simply drawing cartoons, I was creating comic books and, in effect, publishing, even at a very early age.
At Sayre Elementary, Hefner starts the school paper, but in junior high, his creative drive is diverted by a new interest, girls. Encounters on the dance floor lead to lessons about the facts of life, which Hefner learns from a most unusual teacher, his mother.
She had this little book that showed where babies came from. Didn't really deal with sex. It dealt with procreation.
She would tell us without emotion, just the facts.
The fact Hefner is most curious about is what naked women look like. He turns to Esquire magazine to find out. Due to its suggestive cartoons and erotic artwork, Esquire magazine is considered to be more than a little risque, which appeals to Hefner.
I fell in love with those cartoons, those pinup pictures.
At 15, Hefner creates Shudder magazine. It focuses on his love of movies and horror films. But later, not satisfied with just writing about horror movies, Hefner decides to make one. He casts his best friend, Jim Brophy, as a monster. Hefner plays a scientist, and a girl named Betty Conklin plays the scientist's wife. Hefner first met Betty at a soda shop and was instantly smitten.
He came over to my house the next day with a bicycle built for two, and we went for a ride.
Hefner longs for a romantic relationship, but he doesn't make his feelings known to Betty.
We were such good friends, you know, that I just never imagined that it was anything else.
So instead, Hefner's leading lady begins dating another boy. Hefner's hopes for a Hollywood ending are dashed, and the incident becomes the defining moment in his young life. Hefner decides that in order to get the next girl, he must change, and transforms himself from an average Joe into a budding playboy.
He started calling himself Hef, and he tried to present a more positive picture of himself.
It certainly redefined my persona, but it also made me a little cautious in terms of commitment, too.
Without Betty Conklin, there might never have been a playboy.
Jim Brophy said when we all got together in our 60s that if Hef had married me, that he'd be doing Jack and Jill magazine.
He was searching for that love, and just whatever ramifications he had from not having gotten that love made him, you know, really go out and want to conquer.
In his junior year of high school, Hefner becomes a creative big man on campus. He writes for the school paper, produces an autobiographical comic strip, and shines as a comedian.
Hef and his good friend Jim Brophy did these comic routines. It was so corny that people threw money up on the stage and they'd get out their brooms and sweep it up.
The last 2 years of high school are the most important time of my life before the beginning of Playboy, and the best time of my life.
It is during high school that Hefner begins toying with sex, but due to his Puritan upbringing, his activity is limited.
I went steady for the first time in my senior year, and that was the beginning of some sexual experimentation, but didn't include intercourse.
When Hefner graduates in 1944, he makes several most lists, including most popular and most likely to succeed. He is set to take on the world of publishing, but instead, Hefner enters a world at war. At 17, he enlists in the Army, but before shipping out, Hefner meets fellow classmate Millie Williams at a post-graduation party. Hefner had not known Millie during high school, and still longing for romance, he befriends her.
I think that the relationship grew to some extent because at an unconscious level, I wanted to have somebody back home to write to, you know, to have a girl back home.
Hefner is stationed stateside. He and Millie correspond during his 2 years of service. They spend his furloughs together, and eventually Hefner's dream comes true when they fall in love. Coming up, romance is betrayed.
Once you had intercourse, it was a no man's land.
And how a rising star helps Hugh Hefner change America's attitude towards sex.
The Calendar Publishing Company had these nude photographs of Marilyn Monroe.
World War II ends in 1946. It is a time of opportunity for those coming home, including Hugh Hefner, who attends the University of Illinois, where his girlfriend, Millie Williams, is enrolled. Millie is studying to be a teacher. Hefner aspires to become a publisher and creates a college humor magazine called Shaft. But it's not the humor that makes the publication a success. Hefner's magazine owes its popularity to a prophetic feature he calls Co-Ed of the Month. Eventually, Hefner and Millie become engaged, not long after the Kinsey Report is published. Hefner is amazed by its findings, which indicate that Americans have sex more often and in more ways than they admit. Still a virgin at 22, Hefner feels left out.
Hefner eventually persuaded Millie to go all the way, as it was then known, in a hotel room.
The thou shalt nots of that period were related to not having intercourse until you got married. Once you had intercourse, it was a no man's land.
When Millie takes an out-of-town teaching job, Hefner quickly discovers the downside of his fiancée's newfound sexual freedom.
While she was away, she had an affair. It was the single most devastating experience of my life.
Despite his disappointment, Hefner doesn't leave Millie. They are wed in June of 1949, but the marriage is not ideal.
I think to some extent she recognized that we were probably not well suited for one another. And I think that's probably the real reason for the affair.
The newlyweds look past their problems and fall in step with the expected middle-class life. In 1950, Hefner is hired as an ad copywriter at a department store. He works with then-unknown artist Leroy Neiman, who sees in Hefner the signs of a future playboy.
He was a collector of sex memorabilia, just like the sports freaks are today.
Hefner's sex collection includes softcore porn known as blue movies, which are nearly impossible to get during the increasingly conservative time.
There was no open market in terms of pornography. It was an underground phenomenon. I was probably the only kid in my group of friends who owned a couple of stag films.
Eventually, Hefner produces his own erotic material. That Toddle in Town, a book of suggestive cartoons, is a moderate success in Chicago and leads to a job for Hefner at Esquire. But the magazine no longer features the pinup girls of Hefner's youth. Disappointed, he leaves to work for a company which publishes nudist magazines.
Seeing that market combined with my year at Esquire made me feel that it was possible to create a quality magazine that included some nudity.
But Hefner puts the daring idea on hold when Millie announces she is pregnant. In 1952, the couple's three-year marriage is strengthened with the birth of daughter Christy. A month after Christy's arrival, Hefner performs in a high school alumni show. The program is a huge success, but the experience discourages Hefner, who's come to realize he is unhappy with domestic life.
I felt a tremendous sense of loss, a feeling that I was turning into my own parents, and that there had to be something more in life.
For a future, Hefner looks to his past.
I started Playboy to try and recapture the dreams and the magic that I sensed in the last 2 years of high school. What I wanted to create was a lifestyle magazine for young men.
It's a struggle at first. Hefner has to borrow $600, a big sum in 1952, just to start his venture. It's not nearly enough, but Hefner has a plan involving one of Hollywood's sexiest stars.
The Calendar Publishing Company in Chicago had the rights to these nude photographs of Marilyn Monroe shot in 1949 when she was still a struggling starlet.
Hefner uses most of his borrowed money to buy the publishing rights to the Marilyn images. Armed with a nude celebrity, all Hefner needs now is a name for his publication. Originally, he calls it Stag Party.
And some hunting magazine said, well, you can't use the word stag. So they came up with the idea of Playboy.
And what about the famous logo? People have wondered about its significance for years.
All I did at the last minute was simply take a rabbit head and put it on top of the same drawing. So this rabbit actually has hooves.
Hefner's quick thinking is the finishing touch for a magazine that will radically change America's attitude towards sex, both in the bedroom and in society at large.
We sent Today reporter Barbara Walters to the Bunny School.
In 1953, the seeds are sown for the sexual revolution in America. By then, the first contraceptive pill has been developed, and Dr. Alfred Kinsey publishes Sexual Behavior and the Human Female. It's the perfect time for Hugh Hefner to launch Playboy, and he does it by publishing the naked Marilyn Monroe pictures he has acquired.
And at the same moment they appeared in the magazine, she is making gentlemen prefer blondes. I mean, her career and those photos were one of those flashpoints, because it could have gone the other way. She could have been banned from Hollywood. That her career survived that gave a blessing to nudity.
The very first edition of the magazine sells over 70,000 copies. More issues follow. The key to Playboy's success and what will have everybody talking is Hefner's concept of the Playmate of the Month.
Hefner's insight was to say, the girl next door is also naked, is a sexual being, let's photograph her.
The idea that the woman you saw working in the office with you, or the woman who sat three rows over from you in school, actually looked like that underneath her clothes. Wow, that was wonderful.
The magazine also features top-notch fiction, and in later years, important interviews and in-depth social commentary.
I believe Tom Wolfe said it was the sort of penicillin put in there to nullify the effect of the dirty pictures.
But the magazine's hook is sex and the pursuit of pleasure.
Max Lerner, a philosopher, journalist of the 50s, said that in the sexual revolution, Kinsey was the researcher, the theorist.
And Hefner was the pamphleteer. I'm the guy that spread the good word. The sex was not the enemy.
Hefner's message becomes widespread as Playboy's readership grows, but Hefner does not lack critics.
Good evening, I'm Mike Wallace. The show is Night Beat. Our first story is Hugh Hefner. Isn't that really what you're selling, kind of a high-class, dirty book?
Sex always will be an important part of the book, because sex is probably the single thing that men are most interested in.
Oh, but this, I think that you'll agree, it's a sniggering kind of sex. It's a lascivious kind of sex. It certainly isn't a healthy approach to sex. You suggest that it is.
I would not only suggest that, I would say rather strongly, we consider it a pretty healthy act.
Hefner, a workaholic, is completely dedicated to his magazine, which puts strains on his marriage to Millie. In 1955, the couple welcomed their second child, David. But a new baby does not help the faltering relationship. Eventually, Hefner moves a bed into his office and rarely sees his children.
He was more of a kind of a favorite uncle than a dad when we were growing up, in terms of someone I know loved me very much, but not someone who was there day in, day out.
But the magazine isn't the only thing occupying Hefner's time. Playboy's founder soon begins following his own advice.
He had been working 80 hours a week from 1953 on, looked up and started to say to himself, we need to live the life we've been writing about.
The life includes extramarital affairs, which result in Hefner's and Millie's separation in 1957 and their divorce in 1959. Following the breakup, Hefner becomes a full-fledged playboy and takes to the airwaves to promote his new lifestyle and his magazine.
I'm Hugh Hefner, editor-publisher of Playboy magazine, and your host. And this is Playboy's Penthouse. Come on in and meet some of our guests.
That was actually, I think, the first example of a magazine using television as a marketing tool, and it was very successful.
In addition, the new bachelor buys a 30-room mansion and later opens the first of several Playboy clubs, which feature waitresses dressed as bunnies.
I was a bunny for about 3 months when I very first came to New York. I was making maybe $600 a week working lunches on tips.
Bunnies become a new American sex symbol and attract fascination from all corners. In the still unliberated early 60s, a young correspondent named Barbara Walters experiences bunny life firsthand.
Now, for a look at the Playboy Club bunnies and the way they're trained, we sent Today reporter Barbara Walters to the Bunny School.
Standard equipment
is the Bunny Cottontail. The Bunny Manual is 35 pages long. And dating customers or drinking alcoholic beverages before or on the job means automatic dismissal.
When it's rumored that bunnies provide more than food and beverages, Hefner faces new controversy.
We weren't sex workers. Although we certainly were lookers, for the most part.
You know, the amazing thing is, though, they are more chaperoned, really, than in a television studio.
It has been said even that the atmosphere is almost depressingly moral in the Playboy Club, because there's no hanky-panky whatever. And the furor that's raised about it kind of is ridiculous.
Hope really springs eternal.
Well, the average businessman finds fun at the clubs. Hefner hosts nightly private parties at his mansion.
It was fun. The parties were good. There was a certain style. There was a wine cellar. There was good food.
There was a pool there, and you could go down into a bar and look through a glass and watch people swimming around in the pool.
There were intellectuals and professors and rabbis and everything else, dropout priests.
But mostly there are women, many women, including several bunnies who pay rent to live in a dormitory on the mansion's top floor. During this time, pajamas become Hefner's attire of choice both night and day. His bedroom also serves as his office, and a rotating, vibrating, round bed doubles as Hefner's desk.
In his adult life, he really is living out what he started in his early childhood. He really preferred to be in his pajamas as opposed to anything else when he was a little kid. Didn't really want to go out of the house, wanted to do his work there. And when he got enough money and power, that's exactly the lifestyle that that he then lived.
Everything he wanted was within the mansion. So he devised the notion that the world could come to him and he didn't need to go out.
Hefner's involvement in the Playboy life and the life of Playboy magazine leaves him little time for things outside the manor.
Years would pass and Hefner would never leave the mansion. So his lifestyle became increasingly eccentric.
Hefner's eccentricity is a prelude to drug addiction and ultimately the death of a dear friend.
Bobby Arnstein was the keeper of the pills.
This is Headliners and Legends with Matt Lauer.
In the early 1960s, Hugh Hefner lives the Playboy life within the walls of his Chicago mansion. At the same time, he is no mere figurehead at what's quickly becoming the world's top men's magazine. Hefner is a hands-on publisher whose commitment borders on obsession.
I'm a pretty easygoing person, but I'm also a perfectionist.
You can go back and read memos at the start of this magazine where there's a cartoon and it's a comedian in front of a chorus line of dancers. And Hefner wrote a letter back to the cartoonist saying, "The right breast on the 13th dancer looks weird, change it."
But as Playboy prospers, Hefner's obsession takes an unhealthy turn. So far, he has avoided getting caught up in addictive vices, but that changes.
I was working and playing around the clock in those days and discovered early on that dexedrine could keep you awake.
Dexedrine, an amphetamine, is used and abused by Hefner.
I was just taking a little orange pill. And, you know, I would work, you know, 20, 24, 30, 36 hours, and then crash and then start again.
Fueled by the prescription drug, Hefner increases his workload and begins writing the Playboy philosophy. In the monthly opinion column, Hefner addresses the politics of a Playboy's life.
He's wrestling with issues that are still haunting us, from birth control and abortion to prostitution to free expression to censorship. It's more like a barroom brawl than a nicely outlined philosophy, but boy, it touches on every core issue.
He locked himself in his bedroom there for, I think, a couple of years practically, writing his philosophy.
Hefner's company is not hurt by his continued seclusion, but his continued drug abuse is hurting his health. With the help of his executive assistant, Bobby Arnstein, Hefner takes steps to overcome his habit.
She was the keeper of the pills, and he would instruct her ahead of time to not, you know, only to give him so many, and she would try and help him to get off it. I think that he's in remarkable health now for the length of time that he was on the Dexys and the quantities that he took.
In 1969, Hefner ventures out of Chicago and travels to Los Angeles, where he hosts a new TV series called Playboy After Dark. On one of his first shows, he is attracted to a young student.
I was 18 years old, a student at UCLA. The first day I met him on the show, he needed somebody to pretend to be his girlfriend.
And this is, what's your name again?
Oh, come on.
This is my favorite, come on, Barbie Benton.
Hefner finds in Benton the fantasy romance he longed for as a boy.
Barbie Benton was a real love affair. That was Betty Conklin reincarnated.
She knocked my socks off. She was beautiful.
She would just look up at him like there was no other person on this earth.
When he started dating Barbie, I was, I'm going to say, around 15, 16 years old. What I took away from it was a strong sense that he was enjoying life in a different way than he had before.
And was he ever enjoying it? Made rich by his image, Hefner is able to pamper himself, and both on the ground and in the air, he fulfills his every desire.
Hef bought a DC-9 stretch, had it painted black, and he made sure to put a complete bedroom on the plane.
The plane is also equipped with a dance floor and a screening room.
It was the first time he did real travel. You know, they went to Europe, they went to Africa. I enjoyed just seeing him leave the confines of the mansion, and I think that for him was great.
In 1970, Hefner returns to the center of controversy when feminists challenge the concept of the Playboy bunny.
Here is a magazine supposedly devoted to sexual liberation, but it reduces women to the figure of an inconsequential animal.
You choose to see women as sex objects. You make them look like animals, yes. Women aren't bunnies, they're not rabbits, they're human beings. The day that you are willing to come out here with a cottontail attached to your rear end.
Undeterred by feminists, Hefner expands his sex empire with the purchase of a lavish home in Los Angeles. He fills it with playmates and celebrities and creates the ultimate male fantasy, the Playboy Mansion West.
The wildest parties were in the 70s, here with the grotto and the pool.
There's much of that I was unaware of until, I guess there's a lot of guys who can say this, until my marriage fell apart. And then I found myself spending more time at Hef's.
All is well in Hef's empire. In 1971, he takes the company public, which elevates his personal worth to $157 million and establishes him as one of America's richest self-made men. But before long, trouble enters Hefner's world. It starts in 1974 with a scandal involving one of Hefner's closest confidants, and it threatens to destroy everything he has created. Bobby Arnstein, Hefner's executive assistant, knows all the inner workings of the Playboy operation.
She controlled access to Hefner within the mansion, which gave her enormous power.
All the holidays and, you know, family times, she would be there, and frankly, I think did a lot of the shopping for my dad, for me particularly.
But she was an unstable young woman. Her lover died tragically in a car crash, and she was very destabilized by this, and she began taking drugs.
On March 21st, 1974, federal agents apprehended Bobby Arnstein outside Hefner's Chicago mansion for allegedly trafficking cocaine. Her arrest is the tip of a much bigger iceberg.
There were all kinds of stories going around that drug use was rife in the mansion and that Hefner's plane was being used to transport drugs.
Federal and local authorities try to get Arnstein to implicate Hefner, but when she refuses to do so, Arnstein is tried, and using the perjured testimony of a convicted drug dealer, prosecutors convince the jury of her guilt. Arnstein's sentence is 15 years in federal prison.
My lawyer suggests that I not give any statements. It's not my personal feeling. Sorry.
2.5 months later, after working for Hefner for 12 years, Bobby Arnstein commits suicide.
She felt guilty about what her arrest was doing to the Playboy business and to Hefner by association, and the fact she was a troubled woman. that led her to take her own life.
My brother was devastated.
Whatever mistake she may have made in her personal life, she deserved better than this. She was one of the best, brightest, most worthwhile women I have ever known. She will be missed.
In the end, Hefner was exonerated. I mean, there was an investigation, and the authorities had to admit that actually there was no evidence. But he never got over the fact that Bobbie Arnstein killed herself.
Hefner's world is no longer a fantasy, and in the coming years, the death of a playmate will further corrupt the dream.
He had tried to warn her about how dangerous her husband was.
In 1996, Hugh Hefner turns 70. By then, when many people his age are settling into retirement, Hefner has begun a second family. And as he settles into his new role as husband and father, he carries on an old tradition of screening classic and current films for his friends. The 30-year custom reflects Hefner's passion for the medium that first revealed to him the concept of romantic love.
I think most of my life has been a kind of a quest for that romantic ideal reflected in the music and the movies of my childhood.
His love for the movies leads him to donate millions toward the advancement of cinema and for the preservation of films that inspired his life. In 1996, Hefner's commitment to the movies is recognized when a chair is named in his honor at the USC Film School. Hefner's philanthropic efforts are longstanding. In 1965, while writing the Playboy Philosophy, Hefner established the Playboy Foundation, a corporate giving program committed to furthering personal freedom and social justice.
He started the foundation to, as he put it at the time, put his money where his mouth is. He has always believed that part of being successful is an opportunity and an obligation to give back.
In 1997, Hefner and Kimberly celebrate their 8th wedding anniversary, but their relationship has begun to crumble. Unlike Hefner's previous marriage, the rift has nothing to do with infidelity. Kimberly hasn't been able to accept all aspects of Hefner's life.
We just seem to grow apart. His needs were something different than my needs.
I think that the main reason that they drifted apart is because Kimberly's a very private person, and Hef is just the opposite. He has people in his life all the time.
In January of 1998, Hefner and Kimberly separate.
I gave it a very good try. I love her very much. I was devoted to her and to the marriage.
As with many aspects of Hefner's uncommon life, the arrangement of the couple's separation is unique.
She lives immediately next door. The children and Kimberly are here almost every day. So in a certain way, it's the best of both worlds. I really thought that the marriage was the final chapter of my life. Turned out not to be so.
Hefner's next chapter is his resurgence on the social scene. The parties at the mansion begin again, and a new generation joins in.
When I walked in, I thought there'd be like valets. There's just fairies and nymphs parking your car. You know, you're greeted by wizards and magicians and ethereal witches, and it's just amazing.
But what's more amazing is 74-year-old Hefner's unusual romantic arrangements.
He has a wonderful love life. But rather than just one girl, he has a love relationship with 4 girls. It may be a little unconventional, but it works.
Outside the mansion, the 5-partner relationship raises more than a few eyebrows. But those who know Hefner think nothing of it.
I wasn't shocked, actually, on his multiple girlfriends. But everybody, you know, people talk around town and they say, what is this? Is Hef a spokesman for Viagra?
Hef jokingly refers to Viagra as the best legal recreational drug of choice. And if it works that well for him and he swears by it, then it must be so.
At the beginning of the year 2000, Chicago, the city of Hefner's birth, recognizes him with a street named in his honor. But the tribute draws criticism.
Hugh Hefner built his empire off of selling the idea that women are submissive playthings.
Do
We honor it as a city.
I guess none of us estimated that Playboy is still in some quarters very controversial, which is, I think, part of what sustains the success of the magazine.
Hefner the man credits much of his own success to Hefner the boy.
And I remain today very, very close to that boy.
That's what makes him so creative. I think you have to be a child to be creative.
He is Peter Pan. I'll never grow up. He loves bringing back those childhood feelings, which is why he probably likes young women, because he gets to be a boy again.
I see him every day. On a daily basis, that little kid in him is chuckling about how all of this has happened.
He set out to live a movie. He created a stage set for that movie. He's living the romantic dramas of the 30s. He has a great and glamorous life.
But the Playboy's life is not complete. Through the years, through his magazine, and through his relationships, Hefner has been on a search for one thing that seems unattainable.
A world where the songs are true. I've spent my life in that quest, looking for that perfect romantic connection where the words of the songs are true.
Hugh Hefner's career began with Marilyn Monroe, so he's decided why not make her part of his final chapter as well. Hefner has actually reserved the burial crypt next to Monroe's resting place in Los Angeles. Side by side, Playboy's founding swinger and his premier playmate. I'm Matt Lauer. Thanks for watching.